analysis, hard-hitting interviews, and debates on the issues that affect our lives.
And I'm Eileen Alfandary, working with the KPFA news team to bring you breaking news from across the state, the region, and the world. We'll keep you updated on the latest throughout the morning on KPFA.
It's Upfront, a statewide collaboration that brings you information that matters. That's every weekday morning at 7 a.m. right after Democracy Now! Keep it locked to KPFA 94.1 FM in the Bay Area, KFCF 88.1 FM in the Central Valley, or listen online at kpfa.org. I'm Brian Edwards Tiekert. See you at 7.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 3:30. Up next, Making Contact.
I'm Jasmine Lopez, and this is Making Contact.
My mirror has many things to say. I wonder, what does your mirror say?
What does your mirror say? Mine says I'm too short and that I'm not practical enough. As women, we have all these conflicting ideas and images that tell us how to look and behave. This week, we're going to hear from women who use their bodies to upset these dominant ideas. That can come in the form of political protests, as we'll see when we hear a story about Femin, an international group of women bearing all to challenge how the Montreal Grand Prix fuels sex trafficking.
Even in media, they said like, oh, her breast became political now.
But first, a personal piece produced by Making Contact's second ever community storytelling fellow, Aquila Lewis. Lewis produced this piece about her journey into the world of plus-size fashion.
Reflection. Mirror, mirror on the wall. Who was the fairest of them all? Reflections is one of those poems that I think is a personal poem for me.
Seeing things with different eyes.
Because I was thinking about myself and thinking about others who struggle with body image or struggle with weight.
I've always had indents in my flesh.
Their voice really wasn't being heard.
Wishing to be seen, to be understood. I pray for them, and I see them.
And so I was thinking about all those different people, different characters who I see on the street.
She will never look like the Vogue model gracing covers of magazines.
Who I meet in fashion shows.
She remains invisible to this day.
Who are beautiful just because.
I know, because I've been there. Many places. I learned in stages. I heard it whispered in the wind. And fell in love with my reflection.
And so that's what Reflections is all about. And it's a story that needs to be told. My mirror has many things to say. I wonder, what does your mirror say? Body image, there's so many different issues for different people. For me, body image was an issue because I was abused by my dad and my stepdad. And so just remembering what that felt like, it causes my body to really want to hide, run away and hide. And so I don't really like when people look at me. I don't like being touched sometimes because, you know, it brings back the memory of what happened when I was a little girl. And so now body image, I kind of rewrote my story so that I can respect my body and make sure other people respect my body as well. So now my image is great. Before, I had lots of low self-esteem and felt ugly. And so now my body image, I think, you know, looking in the mirror, I really like the way I look with the clothes on or clothes off. So it's a great thing. Body image is a beautiful thing for me now. I feel like I'm in charge. I'm in charge of my destiny. And I'm getting ready to interview some people today. One is the first designer that I worked with when I started on my fashion show journey and some modeling.
We're in the dungeon. That's what I call it. It's the living room that is the Big Old Pretty Girl Factory. My name is Yolanda Yanetta, and I am the owner of Big Old Pretty Girls.
Can you tell me what Big Old Pretty Girls is?
Big Old Pretty Girls is a clothing line. We also sell t-shirts, leggings, yoga pants, and my own personal designs. It's catered more toward us big girls. Big Old Pretty Girls is not about your size. It's the way you live your life.
Yogi's clothes fit me because they're designed for me. I've had an opportunity where she didn't have an outfit, but she made it exactly for my body right in real time. So that was really cool. It was right when we were about to do a fashion show. And I think her talent, that's a talent to me. You can be able to create something when the pressure is on. And there's not very many clothes that I can fit where it fits me, fits my body type, my shape, perfectly. So that's one of the reasons why I chose Yogi. Having clothes that fit comfortably and perfectly, I don't know if it's like that for all women, but for me, it's important because I think I look good and I think my body looks good. It took a while for me to get to this point.
God created you just like you are for a reason. So don't hinder your own self. Love the skin you're in. Let God lead you, because he led me. I dealt with this forever, hating the way my body looked. And then I realized that he made me like this for a reason. I tried to go on every diet known to man to fit in, but I was born to stand out. So Big Old Pretty Girls, right here, worldwide.
Anything else you want to say?
I think I said enough, don't you think?
My body size, I'm over 200 pounds, and I'm short, 5'2". It's really hard for me to find clothes sometimes because I have a big behind, I have big breasts, and everything is, you know, it's kind of large. So sometimes designers, they don't have clothes that are fit for my body type. So I have to be creative and strategic in trying to find the style that best fits me. So it's kind of frustrating sometimes when I go shopping for, depending on what designer, what clothes boutique is out there. And so I've kind of like have a list of things that seem to work, that make me look good, look cute, look fine, beautiful. Whatever I want to look, I have to find those designers that have those clothes that are for me. Now that I'm here, I'm looking for things that just that make me look good, make me look sexy. That's who I am. So.
Hey, Diva.
Hey, how are you?
Fine.
How are you
going? Are you enjoying yourself out here?
I am having fun. There's so much going on around here. I want more people to come by. Bye.
What are you doing right there?
I got a chance to interview Jenny, also known as Diva. She is actually the first designer that I used when I was in fashion shows.
Would you like to know what I do?
Yes, I would. Go ahead and tell me, Diva.
My clothing line is called Diva's Exquisite Designs.
How long have you been a designer?
Oh, my gosh. Well, I've been designing since I was 12. But on this level, say about 5 years.
Her personality is really bubbly, and she is exciting to work with. She saw me when I couldn't walk in heels.
So the reason why I wanted to interview you is because you have been the one designer that I kind of started off with.
Yes.
And yeah, I was looking at some of the pictures from, remember the Theater Funk Collective?
Yes.
The Oasis?
I remember.
Yeah. I was looking at those pictures. And I remember not really being able to walk in heels.
We worked it out. We worked it out.
Do you have any advice for any designers or any plus-size models who want to get into the industry?
There is always a door open for you right now. Always. Such a plus-size. Plus-size is in. It is so in right now. The guys flock to the show because they want to see a little meat on some bones when they walk down the aisle. So plus-size is definitely in. It's not that hard.
working with Yogi and Diva was exciting. They're both passionate. And so when I see someone who's passionate about their work, I'm really interested in working with them. They always respected me. I wasn't disrespected for who I am as a person or as a model. There are so many different stories of models that I've heard of that have been disrespected because of their body, because of their race, because of whatever society, fashion society, has said a model's supposed to look like.
All right, I'm ready. Let's do it.
Right? Now remember, ladies, that song is full of life and energy, and I need y'all to walk with that same energy in life, okay?
Every fashion show is different for me. I think a lot of it is my mood or the clothes that I'm wearing. So being a part of this fashion show, for some reason, is totally different. I feel completely sexy. I feel like I'm alive. I feel like nobody else in the room matters. And I'm enjoying the music. So that's who I am.
You're listening to Making Contact. Because of generous support from listeners like you, this show is distributed for free to radio stations in the U.S., Canada, Australia, and South Africa. To find out how to donate, download shows, or get our podcasts, go to radioproject.org. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Our handle is making_contact.
Over the past couple of years, you may have seen images online of topless women with messages written across their chests, denouncing organized religion, the Pope, the Russian government, and other powers they deem to be oppressive. Well, that group is called Femin, and their modest goal is more or less to end patriarchy. They've been criticized, praised, arrested, and beaten. But who are Femin? Reporter Sujata Day spent some time with some of these women who belong to the group and brings us this story.
Nada Topolowski and Julianne Bulak are wandering around topless, checking their looks in the mirror. Cameras flash. They scream their lines.
Montreal is not a brothel. Montreal is not a brothel.
Montreal is notorious as a city of sin. But no, these women are not amongst the city's many strippers. They are Femin. Feminist, topless protesters.
Montréal is not a brothel. Montréal is not... Tu peux ralentir? Genre...
They're gathered at Topolowski's apartment today to prepare for a secret action. Their target? The Montreal Grand Prix. A testosterone-filled tribute to cars, jocks, and scantily clothed women. Topolowski explains.
But the Grand Prix wanted to highlight the sex industry in Montreal that happens all year long, but that reaches another level during tournament.
The Grand Prix boosts the economy of Montreal, but it also brings in tourists lured by the possibility of strippers and prostitutes. Makeshift brothels are set up. Young girls from youth centers, many of them underage, are brought into work.
Pilots on that race are men. The business of Grand Prix are men. The places in Montreal that make money, it's a few restaurants and hotels owned by men. It's all a male business, and in that equation, girls get fucked and get left tip.
All over the world, women like Topolowski are taking off their tops to protest not only the sex industry, but dictators, religion, and other forms of oppression.
Together! Create history together! Create history together! Create history!
It all started in a sleepy Ukrainian town back in 2008. Four young women, Ina, Anna, Oksana, and Sasha, came together in a Marxist study group to talk about women's problems. They were upset that Ukrainian women were sold into sex traffic. At first, they organized conferences. Galia Ackerman, author of the book Femin, says the next steps were street performances and nudity.
But very quickly, they understood that some magazines, since they are young ladies, quite attractive, some of them, were somehow showing their photos, not in order to show the message, but just to show young girls with bare breasts. They started covering their breasts entirely with graffitis.
On their chest, they write, "I am God. Stop sex tourism. Putin. Fashion victim. And boobs, not bombs," amongst other messages. Crowned in flowers, they ambushed Ukrainian talk shows and politicians, becoming enemies of the former ousted president, Viktor Yanukovych, and the Orange Revolution. But their actions came at a price. Protesting Alexander Lukashenko, the Belarusian dictator, they were kidnapped, stripped naked, taken to the woods, had oil poured on them, and had their hair cut off with knives. In 2012, after cutting down the cross on Kiev's Maidan Square in support of the Russian punk band Pussy Riot, Ina had to seek asylum in France. All four women have since left Ukraine. From exile in Paris, the women are exporting naked feminism all over the world. Countries like Mexico, France, Tunisia, Spain, and Canada all have feminine groups. Boot camps are held where feminine activists do push-ups, running, and learn other skills required to be girl power warriors.
How to look straight in the eyes of your aggressors, how to shout. You have to know how to fight, how to resist to police, how not to smile, how to be taken seriously, how to feel it's your enemy in front of you.
Back in Montreal, Fenia Chernyshova is picking up her three-year-old son from daycare, showing him the joys of butterflies. With her loose clothing, pushing a stroller, it's hard to picture her as a feminine activist. But Chernyshova trained in the Paris boot camp. An actress, she's founder of Femin Quebec. As her parents are originally from Ukraine, she was in Kiev helping Femin out during the Maidan Square protest. After giving birth, she began reflecting on her breasts.
My body changed. Well, no, my breasts changed. And that's why I'm like, many friends are making fun of me. Even in media, they made not fun of me, but they said like, "Oh, her breast became political now." Well, that's good. I gave a second life to my breast after breastfeeding.
As an actress, she often feels typecast as the wide-eyed, angelic, sexy girl. But with Femin, she feels she can be more subversive, more powerful.
Being a sexy girl is also being destroyed by that power. So what really attracted me in Femin also is, okay, so I know I have a power because I'm a sex object, but at the same time, maybe I can use this power to knock out the one who is looking at me, or the one who judge me, or the one who wants something from me, and whatever. Like, I just want to question everybody, and especially myself.
There are some criticisms. Some of the French Femin chapters have targeted Islam, telling women to get naked and dump Sharia, leading many to argue that they are Islamophobic. Topolowski argues that Femin opposes all religions, for they are all patriarchal. She also says that the protests were originated by Muslim women in France. There are also accusations that Femin was run by a man, Viktor Savatsky. Chernyshova says that while Savatsky is a macho control freak, he was a crucial part of the group's founding. Savatsky has since left the group, saying that he is happy Femin has got rid of a small patriarch, namely himself, to take on the big patriarchy. And there are other critics, feminists themselves, who criticize Femin for objectifying women. Topolowski disagrees.
We never try to seduce. We always try to be aggressive, never violent, but always aggressive. We never shut up. We don't go away when we're asked to.
My sexiness, you cannot buy it. you cannot sell it, and you cannot use it, actually. So I'm really using my body and my sex appeal or my appearance in the way I want it.
Like many women, those in femin struggle with society's expectations of beauty, so it can be liberating to take off their clothes.
Ina, she asked a question like, is everybody okay? Like, everybody wants to do it still? And one girl, she said like, well, maybe not me. And one of the other girls said like, is it because of some ideological problem or something else? And she said, well, no, I never showed my body and I don't like my body. Like, I'm not sure I'm going to be able to do it. And then we didn't say nothing. We just like look at her and we just got off our t-shirts. And it was a very empowering and liberating moment, just accepting the way we were. And then you saw like all type of breasts and all type of bodies, and there was no problem anymore.
The only place on the entire Montreal coast is right here, Crescent Street. I use Crescent Budapest Up Challenge, brought to you by Alfa Romeo.
We are on Crescent Street, ground zero of the Grand Prix Festival, a strip of bars known for being a meat market. Today there are sports cars and very loud music. Everyone is trying to get their pictures taken next to the Alfa Romeo, but there are a few more photographers here than normal. The media is waiting for something to happen. They scream, Montreal is not a brothel. For a few seconds, the crowd is stunned. Flashes go off, security guards move in. What happens next is scary.
And so what happened is that actually he dragged me into a tiny street, and then everybody kind of followed, and the media followed, and then to another tiny street, and then nobody followed, and then he hit me on both sides, like next to my stomach, and so I would break, and he broke my wrists, and so I would really just break and shut up, and he really hurt me. And then the police came, and thankfully, because he would have continued.
Topolowski was charged with indecent acts. When it's not the police, often feminist actions are greeted by sexist comments. People call them names, tell them that they're ugly. One woman sent Topolowski an obscene video.
I mean, they see us naked everywhere all the time, in magazines, in porn movies, everywhere. I mean, it's not the nudity that shocks them. It's the fact that it's not in a sexual context and the fact that they don't control it.
And with the media, it's hit or miss. Sometimes they're ignored or overly sexualized or ridiculed or their message is completely lost. Chernyshova says that's all part of the struggle. Femin is not there to make people love them.
There's a lot of manipulation. So for me, it's a war. That's why we call it naked war. Because we are in war with the media. We are in war with the world. We are in war with ourselves, first of all.
For Making Contact, this is Sujatha Day in Montreal, Canada.
Now we'll head to San Francisco to hear about reclaiming one's body as a political statement or tool for empowerment through art.
I am here at the offices of the Global Fund for Women, and in the hallway, before you enter the offices, you have the Global Fund for Women sign, and there are several portraits, about six portraits of women from what seem to be various backgrounds, leaders of some kind. So I'm here to talk with Catherine King. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Welcome.
Thank you.
Global Fund for Women is a grant maker and a global advocate for women's human rights. And we advance the movement for women's human rights by directing resources to and raising the voices of women worldwide. And my role here is to produce multimedia storytelling and digital advocacy campaigns to raise awareness on critical issues for women and girls' human rights globally.
So in today's show, we heard what were stories of empowerment and the reclaiming
of one's body as a political statement. Can you give me an example in some of the work that you've done or that you've seen where they do something similar?
Absolutely. In our recent Imagining Equality project, we exhibited a really powerful series of drawings by a Peruvian Spanish feminist artist named Maria Achacucher. And her series is called Indignadas, or Outraged Women. And what she does is documents the role of women in recent political protests. So, for example, she is taking images drawn from media and from the public of women at protests like the Women of Femin, Pussy Riot, women who participated in Occupy Wall Street, and turning these photographs from the protests into, you know, her work, which is pop art style drawings, as a way to really create a memory bank and to preserve the presence and the voices and the participation of women in these movements. And this is a really, I think, important way for women's voices and their physicality to be presented and to be preserved and to be recorded. And we know that, you know, who is included and who is not included, whether we're talking about representation in an art gallery, in a magazine, in a TV, in movie or film, is as important as who is not included. And so she is making a very conscious effort to say women are part of political protests. They are using their presence, their body, and their voice, and let's capture that and let's make that visible. And her work is there for shown in galleries, but she also blows up some of these images and hangs them in very public places, at other gatherings, outside artist studios, in public spaces.
So that leads me to my next question. Can regular people or small groups really impact the way the female body is perceived? And how can the use of one's body allow those who have been silenced in their communities to have an active voice?
Well, I think what is interesting was an example from a recent project that we initiated, the Imagining Equality project, Your Voices on Women's Human Rights. And this was a project in which we reached out to women around the world, asking them what equality meant to them for themselves, in their own personal lives, in their communities. And we were organizing this project as a way to hear from our global community and to hear from women around the world about issues of human rights that are most pressing to them as we lead up to the new United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And so we were really very interested in how women would envision the future of their rights and what they would like to see preserved, or you know, what human rights they most would like to see prioritized in that agenda. And what came back was incredibly personal. The kinds of responses that we received were about issues that related to body, that related to identity, that related to appearance. You know, all too often, women are seen as sex objects, as childbearers, as workers, are often seen through that lens. Cooking, cleaning, doing work around the house. And what we heard from the women who submitted to this project was that, you know, certainly they shared stories around these issues and these areas, but they really wanted to reclaim their bodily autonomy. They wanted to reclaim how their appearance is perceived. And the stories that came back were about resilience, were about taking ownership for their own health, about ability, about strength, about power, about beauty. Creative, personal, and artistic presentations, especially of difficult content, like content around body, around appearance, around identity, really has the opportunity to reduce the distance between the viewer and the issue, and can make content that's difficult or ideas that are difficult or unfamiliar topics more accessible, more personal, and more approachable.
Catherine King is with the Global Fund for Women. We will link them on our site, radioproject.org. Catherine, thanks so much for your time.
Thank you very much.
And that's it for this edition of Making Contact. Special thanks to a legend at radio station CKCU who recently passed away, Mark Velcour. To learn more about the people and groups in the show or get our podcast, go to radioproject.org. Like us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter. Our handle is making_contact. The Making Contact team includes Lisa Redman, Andrew Stelzer, George Lavender, Quan Booth, and Laura Flynn. I'm Jasmine Lopez. Thanks for listening to Making Contact.
And you're listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3.